Hello once again from the Prim Reaper. This month I'm speaking not only on behalf of myself, but also on behalf of the Canadian Association for Equality. We wanted to put out a video discussing the concept of toxic masculinity in some detail, addressing where the idea came from, examining the original reasoning behind its intention, and how many people are attempting to use it in good faith. However, these days, many people are simply attempting to use it as a bludgeoning tool to push a divisive and hurtful narrative about men. Either way, good faith or not, it's a term that ought to be removed from our collective lexicon, as it causes more trouble than it solves in trying to talk about the issues that men face in our society. The origin of the phrase toxic masculinity is in the mythopoetic men's movement, an early men's movement started in the 1980s that focused on men's challenges through the use of cultural myths and rituals, and was heavily influenced by Jungian psychology. The full discussion of this early men's movement is beyond the scope of this video, but it was essentially a movement dedicated to trying to return a sense of healthy masculinity to men by bringing men together in camaraderie through participation in spiritual rituals and through bringing attention to men's issues in the face of a strong societal focus on the feminine in society. The goal in attending these masculine rituals was essentially to combat the problem of men losing touch with their sense of manhood by putting them in touch with a more natural, mature, and healthy masculinity. This mature masculinity was in contrast to the immature, toxic masculinity, in which men would try to overcompensate for what they'd lost by devolving into hyper-masculine caricatures that often behaved in destructive and unhelpful ways. And incidentally, also in contrast to men who had taken the opposite path and become too feminized. I'm sure you'll all be amused and not at all surprised to learn that the primary responses I found while researching this early men's movement were articles that were often highly critical of it. Men's behavior. Is the mythopoetic men's movement creating new obstacles for women? The mythopoetic men's movement has been widely spoofed as the whining of middle-aged white men seeking solutions to their problems by chanting and drumming in the woods. Caricatured or uncritically celebrated by the mass media, the movement has received little scholarly attention, despite its size and cultural influence. These books begin to remedy this gap. The New Men's Movement, Retreat and Regression with America's Weekend Warriors. Abstract. The New Men's Movement, signaled by the popularity of works by Robert Bly and Sam Keane, and the hundreds of weekend mythopoetic retreats, indicates a growing restlessness among American men. This essay examines the assumptions and political implications of the mythopoetic men's movement and presents a feminist-inspired critique. First, we describe the movement's essentialist assumptions about gender, stressing the ways these assumptions reproduce power inequalities between women and men. Second, we explore the psychoanalytic diagnosis of male malaise and argue that feminist psychoanalysis provides a more compelling case. Third, we explicate the celebration of anthropological initiation rituals and place these rituals within larger cultural contexts of male-female relationships. Fourth, we describe the historical antecedents for the current mythopoetic retreats, suggesting the structural conditions under which fears of feminization of manhood are likely to be expressed. Finally, we discuss the sociology of developmental regression contained within the mythopoetic vision, arguing that what is to be retrieved is not deep manhood, but deep boyhood, a playfully innocent and romanticized view of masculinity without adult responsibility of work and family. We claim that only by developing an explicitly pro-feminist politics can men's lives be meaningfully changed. Forgive me a brief moment of immaturity in response to that last one, but...
Now comes the part where we throw our heads back and laugh. Ready?
Ready!
Honestly, it's a little disingenuous that so much of the scholarly literature is so critical of the pro-gender group of the term toxic masculinity, and yet those who like to use the term are quick to jump behind the defense tactic of, but toxic masculinity isn't referring to all masculinity. After all, it was even originally created by a men's group. But let's not linger on that. Like it or not, there are individuals who are trying to use the term in good faith. People who do this claim that men are unnecessarily forced into a narrow caricature of manhood, as though aspects of their masculinity are a prison foisted upon them by rigid societal constructs that disallows them from being their true selves, from being comfortable expressing their emotions, and being comfortable getting help for their mental health. Instead, toxic masculinity encapsulates all of the behaviors that men might engage in as a compensatory tactic when they don't feel like enough of a man, or simply encapsulates the more problematic behaviors characteristic of traditional masculinity, or may simply refer to a type of behavior that both men and women engage in but might be more likely to be seen in men. Wait a moment here. This toxic masculinity thing is beginning to suspiciously resemble one of those inconsistent terms that can mean whatever we need it to in order to further our narrative. But hold that thought. I'll return to that in a minute. The fact of the matter is, many people who use this term are earnestly trying to figure out ways to help men who are struggling. I would argue that this is misguided, but we can hardly blame the average person for doing this. For a long time now, the social sciences and other scholarly disciplines exploring how human beings exist in and relate to the world around them have relegated men's needs to the background for quite some time now, with the focus instead being on the special needs of women and other various minority groups. Far be it from me to say that these groups do not require a focus that pays attention to their specific and unique needs, but the same should be and arguably currently isn't true for men. Instead, we're often approaching men's mental health and men's way of being in the world from a feminine perspective, and because the feminine way is so very different from the masculine way, this can often unfortunately lead us to pathologize normal male behaviors. This can be seen in many different stages of a man's life, from the criticism of boys' energy and ways of learning in childhood, to the damning of clumsy, hormone-fueled attempts to solicit attention from the opposite sex in adolescence and early adulthood, to the looking down upon of the competitive ambition that often characterizes the traditionally male-dominated business and political worlds. With this slow creep of finding fault in many different behaviors that were once considered normal, it should come as no surprise that the behaviors that are falling under the umbrella of toxic masculinity are often a shifting sand depending on the resources you happen to read. I examined several different resources for the purposes of this video, and all of them have their own idea of what toxic masculinity looks like. Let's take a look at some of those examples now. In The Good Men Project, toxic masculinity is a narrow and repressive description of manhood, designating manhood as defined by violence, sex, status, and aggression. It's the cultural ideal of manliness, where strength is everything while emotions are a weakness, where sex and brutality are yardsticks by which men are measured, while supposedly feminine traits, which can range from emotional vulnerability to simply not being hypersexual, are the means by which your status as man can be taken away. In Teaching Tolerance, What We Mean When We Say Toxic Masculinity. After decades of study, I deeply believe that men are not naturally violent, but in a culture that equates masculinity with physical power, some men and boys will invariably feel like they are failing at being a man. For these particular men and boys, toxic masculinity has created a vacuum in their lives that can be filled through violence, through the abuse of women and of children in their care, through affiliation with the so-called alt-right or ISIS, through gun violence or any other promise of restored agency that those parties wrongly equate with manhood. In social media behavior, toxic masculinity and depression, hegemonic masculinity is a manifestation of masculinities that is characterized by the enforcement of restrictions in behavior based on gender roles that serves to reinforce existing power structures that favor the dominance of men. A subset of hegemonic masculinity is toxic masculinity. Similar to hegemonic masculinity, toxic masculinity is characterized by the enforcement of rigid gender roles, but also involves the need to aggressively compete with others and dominate others. Toxic masculinity is characterized by a drive to dominate and by endorsement of misogynistic and homophobic views. A large body of literature has linked endorsement of misogynistic and homophobic attitudes with scores on measures of masculinity ideology and adherence to masculine gender role conformity. In masculinity might be more toxic than we think, the influence of gender roles on trait emotional manipulation. Our results show that, particularly for men, masculine gender roles powerfully predict emotional manipulation. The intersect between the male sex and the masculine gender role in predicting emotional manipulation is even more pronounced when considering no sex difference was found between males and females' self-reported masculine gender roles. Of further interest is that low feminine gender roles were significantly associated with emotional manipulation in females only. Future research could further explore how masculinity interacts with the male sex to produce higher emotional manipulation, and how femininity interacts with the female sex to produce lower emotional manipulation. Consistent with other recent research, our data reveal the potentially toxic nature of masculinity and provide possible groundwork for future prevention and intervention of emotional manipulation. And last but not least, in Toxic Masculinity in the Age of #MeToo, Ritual, Morality, and Gender Archetypes Across Cultures, 1.4.2, Toxic Masculinity in Comparative Focus. Toxic masculinity is a highly salient but awkwardly fitting feature in the conceptual architecture of the social justice moral culture I discussed above. In the grander scheme of human structures of myth, toxic masculinity is simply a worst-case ideal type, i.e., a fairy tale with some basis in biology and broad cross-cultural relevance. The toxic masculinity myth serves the useful purpose of promoting socially desirable behavior among males. Men should not be bullies, and men should not rape. What healthy mind would disagree with that? As you can see, the term rarely has any real consistency, except that it can be molded like Play-Doh to fit whatever shape the author may need to criticize some aspect of masculine behavior. Or in some cases, not even masculine behavior, but simply a behavior that men may be more likely to display than women. Without a proper working definition of the term, we couldn't use the concept consistently to create studies or write scholarly papers even if we wanted to. And not only do we not have a proper working definition for the term, but its vagueness lends itself to, well, overextending itself. Look at the APA's guidelines for men and boys. There, not only toxic masculinity comes under fire, but even traditional masculinity is now claimed to lead to mental unwellness. So we can present this as a counterexample to those who say, but toxic masculinity isn't about criticizing all masculinity, as we've seen the direction this conversation tends to flow. Often, the way it works out, we become more comfortable with finding fault with any attributes we can link more commonly to the male sex, all the while pointing the finger and saying, "See? This is why men are having problems." Though we don't seem to come to the same conclusions when women display these more traditionally male behaviors, of course. Not only this, but a focus on the term toxic masculinity, whether used in good faith or to push a certain narrative, puts the sole focus on what men ought not to do, either because they claim the behaviors are harmful to them or are merely problematic to others. It's finger-waggling disguised as help. Well, when it's not just blatant man-bashing, that is. It's not trying to develop positive internal strengths to build themselves up or become better-rounded, more whole, more contented individuals. It's coming at male behaviors from an external focus, telling them all the ways that certain aspects of themselves are bad for them, strictly from an outside view, without taking into account how these supposed bad behaviors might actually be servicing them. This is especially so when trying to argue that they should drop these toxic behaviors, not for their own sake, but in the service of other people. I mean, nothing says mental health like drop or modify these behaviors inherent to your sex because the other sex finds them inconvenient in some way. The toxic masculinity approach does very little, if not nothing at all, to address the positive aspects of masculinity or to push forward a constructive path to working with men in the unique ways that they require support. The narrative is an ellipsis rather than a period. It trails off right at the part where we would normally expect them to have some idea about what to do about this proposed problem, filling in the blanks, where it is inclined to do so, with vague calls for supporting men to properly express their feelings, without even stopping to ask them if that's what they think their problem is to begin with. I found a disturbing article while doing some research for this discussion. It's an article titled "The Indirect Effect of Perceived Criticism on Suicide Ideation and Attempts" by Christopher Hagen and Thomas Joyner. Let me read you the abstract. The effect of perceived criticism from others is one potentially important risk factor for suicide that has received scant attention despite decades of research on the role of criticism in the treatment and course of mental illnesses such as schizophrenia and mood disorders. This study analyzed the effect of perceived criticism's association with suicidal ideation and attempts, as well as its connection with the suicide-related constructs thwarted belongingness and perceived burdensomeness, as described in the interpersonal theory of suicide. 50 participants, 66% female, mean age 18.7, 18 of whom had previously made one or more suicide attempts, completed a battery of self-report assessments as well as two in-person structured clinical interviews. Analyses demonstrated that perceived parental criticism is a significant factor of suicide ideation and attempts, and that perceived criticism from close friends is a significant factor of suicide attempts. Perceived criticism has a strong indirect effect on suicide ideation and attempts through its effect on thwarted belongingness, but not perceived burdensomeness, while controlling for mental illnesses. Some limitations of this study include the cross-sectional design and the use of a relatively small, restricted age sample. Treatment designed to mitigate perceived criticism and thwarted belongingness may be an important component in combating suicidal ideation and attempts, particularly among young adults. You might notice that this article mentions not even just the effect of actual criticism, but perceived criticism. The authors mention that perceived criticism is linked to the presence and relapse of depression in individuals, as well as to an increased incidence of suicidal ideation. Now, do you notice that every time someone tries to use the toxic masculinity narrative, they have to preface it with promises that it's not a criticism of masculinity as a whole? That's because, whether they like it or not, the way this concept is discussed, and even the negative connotation of the term itself, leads people to believe that, more often than not, it is a condemnation of masculinity as a whole. This being the case, with how much additional criticism, perceived or otherwise, we've seen of men over the last couple of years, is it really any wonder we're seeing an increased incidence of mental health problems and suicides? In contrast to this article, we can also find plenty of supporting evidence in the literature that self-acceptance is consistently positively correlated with measures of mental health. This is yet another reason why we need to find another way to talk about men's mental health instead of the toxic masculinity narrative. After all, how can we possibly expect men to accept themselves when the only thing they keep hearing is how aspects of their masculinity are toxic? If we want to help men, if we want to challenge these kinds of problems that are affecting men at an alarming rate, that are leading men's mental health to suffer, we need to stop coming at them from a deficit perspective. We should reach out to men and ask them the kinds of support they feel they need. After all, men aren't a hive mind any more than women are. Some men might heal with talking about the way they feel, but other men might not. Other men might prefer group support to talk with others in similar situations, or workshops that simply allow them to work and cooperate with other men on unrelated tasks to feel a sense of community and belonging. Regardless of the medium that men might need, regardless of how different it may be or may not be from the kinds of support that women or other groups might need, we should offer them the same kind of empathy and acceptance that we would offer anyone else. This doesn't mean that men's behaviors have to be above criticism, of course, but if we do criticize, we should criticize individual actions in a constructive manner that provides alternatives and stop pretending like they are problems endemic to men or masculinity as a whole. Finally, it might be a nice change of pace for the mental health fields and society as a whole to start remembering all the helpful ways that men contribute to their communities. Let's appreciate the sacrifices that men make to ensure the safety of our communities, to build and maintain our city infrastructures, to do the dirty and dangerous jobs that no one else wants to do, to innovate and invent new tools that make all our lives easier, and to work long hours to support their families. If we remember to appreciate and support all the healthy and positive aspects of our sons, husbands, fathers, and brothers, I think we'll go a lot farther than if we simply sit around and nitpick the supposedly toxic aspects. I'd like to take a moment now to ask again for your support in helping us to open our full-time Center for Men and Families in Calgary this fall. We're working to provide exactly these kinds of supportive services I've been talking about in this video to men in need. This is just one of many initiatives of its kind that CAFE is trying to open across Canada, but if we get your support now, it increases the chances for success not only for our own center, but also for the likelihood of success for other centers across the country. We can make a difference. We can open these services for men in need, but we can't do it without public support. I'll be including the links to the fundraisers in the low bar, and as always, I'll be donating a percentage of my Patreon earnings to every month to the cause as well. That being said, thanks so very much for watching, and I hope to see you all in the next one.